discussed register renaming in detail, how we implement interest offsets, and how you recycle registers. So, and final conclusion was that the reorder buffer size, so reorder buffer was a FIFO structure for maintaining the order of instructions. And it is freed when an instruction retires. So the entry is recycled. And we also deduced a relationship between ROB size and the register file size. And conclusion was that if you have more physical registers, you'll have more in-flight instructions in the processor. And that will allow you to extract more parallelism on the program. And to support, of course, the fundamental assumption here is that to accommodate a larger ROB in-flight instructions, you'll have a large ROB. And to support a large ROB, you'll require an equally large physical register file. And we also produced a relationship cluster. So one small thing that was left was about memory renaming. So register renaming essentially deals with the problem of name dependence. That is, if the compiler ran out of registers, it might have picked a register for storing the result of an instruction, and that might interfere with the output of some other unrelated instruction, or the operand of some unrelated instruction. So these are the write after write and write after read dependencies. And these are purely artifacts of compilers shorting of registers. And register renaming, with a much larger register set inside the processor, tries to solve that problem. So ideally, if you have a large enough register file, you would only be limited by data flow dependence, that is, the true read after write dependence, nothing else. So memory renaming is the other thing that deals with. So the problem is exactly similar. You have there are two situations. So essentially, we're talking about war and war hazards. So war is basically between outputs of two instructions. So the outputs happen to be the same. The outputs happen to have the same storage for two unrelated instructions. Then you have a write after write dependence. And here, essentially, we're talking about between output and input of two unrelated instructions. Where the read happens before the write. So you read from a register, later you write to the same register in a different instruction. So the second instruction had to do the write to the same register simply because the compiler could not find a different register. Right? So the memory dependence is exactly the same. We're talking about two dependencies here. So here it will happen between two stored instructions. Two stored instructions write to the same memory location. However, this one is not really an artifact of any compiler resource shortage or anything. It's basically a program property that two stored instructions write to the same location. Right? And so that's a write after write hazard. And as such, fundamentally, it's impossible to remove because the writes have to happen to the same memory location. There's no exception. Here, we're talking about a store followed by a load. So, and the store writes to a memory location X. A load followed by a store. So a load reads from memory location X, and the store writes to the same memory location X. All right? So again here, so you can see the problem. The problem is that if you switch the order of these two instructions, the load is going to get a wrong value. Right? Okay, so essentially you have load some register R1 to some address, from some address, and then after a bunch of instructions, you have a store, which stores to the same address. Okay, and you have to maintain this order. The load has to happen before the store. There is no exception. Otherwise, the load is going to get a wrong value from this address. So that's the war hazard in memory. Now, the question that we're trying to answer is, so this one is war, and the war is basically a store from some register to some address, and then you have another store after a bunch of instructions from some register to the same address. Okay. So that's the war hazard. The question is there any way that we can actually ignore this order? And the simple reason of ignoring this order would be that the store may get ready before the load. So there will be reasons to execute the store earlier. Alright? So the question here also, this store may get ready before this store. By being ready, we mean that R10 becomes available before R1. Alright? And here R10 becomes available before R1, plus there may be certain dependencies in the address. So the question is, can we do that? And the answer is yes. So we're going to use exactly the same philosophy as we did in the register naming case. What we'll do is, inside the processor, we'll have some special storage for holding the values of the stored instructions. Okay. And this is essentially called a store buffer. So store address renaming is still done through the store queue entries. So you remember that we distributed our issue queue across functional limits. So we had an integer ALU issue queue, we had a floating point ALU issue queue, we had a store queue, and we had a load queue, right? So the store queue entries are a little special in the sense that they have a field for storing the value box that stores will write. And as such, you need such a field anyway, because a store may execute at any point in time, but it cannot update memory until it comes to the head of the ALU. So now we can actually execute these two stores out of order, ignoring this particular order, because the values as such will be copied from, in this case, will be copied from R1 to its particular store queue entry. The value here will be copied from R10 to this store's store queue entry. And ultimately, of course, they will update memory in order when they go to the head of the ROP. The advantage here is that we are able to overlap address computation of these two instructions, overlap, or again, you know, we can run them concurrently as such if we have enough resources. And we can execute any of these whenever it gets ready. Okay. So you can compute the addresses, and we can read the register files out of order and put the values in the store queue entry. And of course, eventually, the memory update will happen. Similarly here, I can issue this store ignoring this load completely, right, and put the value in the store queue entry of this particular store. However, you have to be a little careful when you issue this load eventually. Okay. So that has to be taken care of. So this is here the whole process is summarized. So store address renaming is still done through store queue entries. Different stores to overlapping addresses can issue out of order and compute addresses and read values to be stored from the register file. Right? Here I mentioned particularly overlapping address because that is the problematic one. Okay, that is where the dependence arises. If the addresses are independent and non-overlapping, then of course I can execute them in whatever order I want. Stores commit in order, and this is when memory is updated with a new value. So memory update is still in order. That has to be kept in mind. Okay. What is a load selection protocol? So loads issue out of order when ready, and all stores before it have already computed address. So this one we have already discussed, right? So we had an order between loads and stores. So you can imagine a fused load store queue as a single FIFO. All right. So I have a load instruction here. Let's say. So what it's saying is that you can issue this load instruction whenever you want, whenever the operands of the load instruction are ready. However, you have to do one thing, that is, you have to check if all the stores before this load have already issued or not. And by issuing, already issued and computed address or not. Okay. So that has to be guaranteed, because whenever this load will issue, it will check if its address overlaps with any of the store's address. Okay. And if it does, we have discussed what needs to be done in the last class. That so depending on the overlapping type, you may either take a value from the youngest store before the load, or you can let the load wait until the particular conflict has been resolved. Okay. So this one looks a little naive.
Okay.
So we'll soon improve it, because simple reason is that there should be a mechanism to not wait for all the stores to finish, because this load may not depend on all the stores, may only depend on one of the nodes here. So this is a very conservative approach, which is still correct, but maybe lower performance. So we'll improve upon this very soon. And load execution happens in two phases, as we discussed earlier. First, the load will issue and compute addresses. So first of all, this criteria have to be satisfied for the load to issue. And when the load ultimately issues, it will first compute the address, okay? And then it compares the address with all stores before it, right? So of course, to know if this criterion is satisfied or not, this has to happen first. The load has to compute the address. So the way it is done is that whenever the load operations are ready, I'll issue it. Okay, all right, it will compute the address, it will come back, check all the stores here, okay, all the addresses, and then if there is a match, it will do something. If there is no match, then of course there is no store. Okay. So what we have achieved effectively is that we have improved concurrency between the memory instructions. And it is done by doing the memory renaming through the store queue entries. So you have a temporary incarnation of this particular address. Okay. This becomes one store queue entry. And it's temporary. As long as the store remains inside the processor, this particular store queue entry signifies this particular address. Okay, so after you do all these things, what limits ILP now? So number one is instruction fetch latency. If you have to go to the memory to bring the instructions every cycle, that's going to be very slow. Right? So you need an instruction cache. So we'll talk about caches after this. So instruction caches should hold, depending on the management policy of the cache, most recently used cache memories. And hopefully you can reuse them over time. Second problem is branch miss prediction. So observe that you predict a branch in decode, and the branch executes the exit stage on the pipeline. So there are several pipeline stages before the outcome is known. So misprediction amounts to a loss of at least NF instructions, where F is the fetch width. We have too many in cycle branch penalty, right? So that's pretty obvious. Because every cycle I'm fetching F instructions, if I have an in cycle branch penalty, if I make a misprediction, I would have to make NF number of useless instructions, wrong instructions. I have to throw them away. So that's a huge loss, actually. If you have a very deep pipe, or if you have a very large fetch width, the implication is that you should have a very good branch predictor, right? To reap the benefit of the third one is slow memory. So just to give you a feel about this problem, here is one particular data point. Nothing to do with any particular processor, just an arbitrary point to convey the problem here. So let's assume that you have an issue with the 4, right? Meaning that every cycle you can have maximum 4 instructions. Assume that the frequency of the processor is 3 gigahertz. Memory latency is 120 nanosecond. So then the question is, suppose one memory operation is currently in flight.
Okay, all right.
So particular memory operation, load us. Let's say a load instruction.
Okay, all
right. So to be able to hide the latency of this particular load operation, how many instructions do I need? So what does it mean? I have to hide this much of latency. So the processor, it should look like as if there was no memory operation. So during these 120 nanosecond time window, the processor should continue to
issue 4 instructions every cycle. Okay. Just to find somehow 4 independent instructions every cycle. Okay, all right. So what does it amount to? 120 nanosecond is 360 cycles, okay, 3 gigahertz. All right. Multiplied by 4 is 1440 instructions. Okay. So if a lower instruction is outstanding, that means if I want to hide this whole latency, I must be able to find 1440 independent instructions to issue during this time. So fundamental requirement to be able to do that is that I need an ROB of size 1440, at least. Otherwise, I won't be able to get more independent instructions. So essentially, this is impossible. It's not just not possible, actually. And the main problem is shortage of resources. You cannot support such a large ROB. And if you want to support such a large ROB, you need an equally large register file. We talked about that. Okay. Register file size may be slightly smaller than this. Okay. So 1440 minus number of logical registers. That's what we discussed last time. Okay. So that's out of question, actually. So this is what ultimately becomes a problem, resource constraints. The ROB size, the register file size, and the issue queue size. So these structures ultimately limit your ILP. And this is related to this particular problem, slow memory. Okay. And in addition to that, you have the other two problems regarding instruction phasing problems. All right, so we'll talk about this particular problem in great detail in the remaining portion of the course, how to resolve this issue, actually. This is a very hot research problem, because this is where today cycles go. When you run a program, and if you try to find out where exactly the program spends time, you find that 70 to 80% or even more amount of time is spent in memory, just accessing memory, that's all. So the data has become extremely slow. That is a big problem, relative to the processor. Give one data point to the processor will compute very quickly and ask for the next data point. You just do not have enough bandwidth or enough intelligence in the system to provide the data that fast. So this is the problem, and we'll discuss some of the solutions that are out there. But till now, you know, it's an open problem and very much open, actually. All right, so any question? Okay, so going back to the basics a little bit, recall that this was our equation for computing execution time. Cycles per instruction times instruction count times cycle time. So far, we have focused on the first component, that is how to reduce the CPM or improve IPC, instructions required per cycle. This one is determined by the quality of the compiler, instruction count. Okay, the architecture as such cannot be much more. The compiler compiles a program, gives you a bunch of instructions to execute. So as far as an architecture is concerned, this is more or less constant. Of course, modular the instruction set architecture. That will decide, of course, the quality of instructions produced by the compiler. Right? But the micro architecture, that is the implementation of the ISA, has nothing to do with instruction count. That's a constant part. So we'll talk about the third component now, a little bit, not much actually. So cycle time reduction is another technique to boost performance. Right? Which essentially translates to having a faster clock. Right? So you want more gigahertz. And you know, an educated person should understand that it's really product of three terms. You cannot ignore the first two terms. At least definitely you cannot ignore the first term. And the first and the last terms are not independent. If you have a very fast processor, occasionally your CPI is very large. So you have to be careful. And that's what we're talking about now. We're going to discuss why that is so. So how do you get faster clock frequency? So there is usually, from an architecture viewpoint, ignoring the device physics and electrical engineering part, there is only one way to do that. That is, you make your pipe stages smaller. Right? So if you have a five-stage pipeline, if you want to double the frequency, you halve each pipe stage. You have a 10-stage pipeline. If you want even more frequency, you keep on having whatever you can. So you have seen that in one of the exam problems, how lengthening the pipe gives you more frequency. So that's what an architect can do. to get faster clock. Okay. Of course, there are other ways to get faster clock. You can have smarter transistors, which can be clocked at a faster rate, faster transistors. Okay. So we're not going to talk about that. So each pipeline stage should be one cycle for balanced progress. So essentially you need to break pipe stages into smaller stages to get faster clock. So what do we know about this? What are the problems of making a pipe deeper? Can anybody recollect? Sorry, say it. Misprediction penalty increases. Branch misprediction penalty, that's what we're talking about. Anything else? Yes?
In case of branch, if you make a misprediction,
if we have to clean
the pipe, it will waste more time.
Yeah, that's what exactly you're mentioning. Increased misprediction penalty. Yeah, increased penalty in terms of cycles, not really absolute time, right? We're not talking about that. In terms of cycles. And that essentially means an increased CPI, ultimately. So, really lowering your cycle time may not buy you a lower execution time all the time. What else? Bypass paths increase in number. Why does it matter? From the point of view of execution time.
So fitting these wires on one board and all, that's not possible, I think.
Not possible in the sense?
Not possible, I mean it takes time, big wiring and all these things.
That takes time to design?
No, not like not design. So okay. Basically, your structure won't be a 1D, won't be a one-dimensional. Like you would have to build layers.
Fine. Okay.
And that would increase latency and all between the signals.
Latency will increase.
Latency will increase.
Okay, because of the length of the wire you're talking about.
Yes.
Length of the wire.
Yes.
Plus, you have even multiplexers.
Comparators.
Exactly. So all these taken together may actually not give you the target clock frequency. You find that, okay, I have a 5-stage pipe with 2 gigahertz frequency, balanced pipe. Okay. Each stage is equal latency, all right? All right, so 5-stage pipe with 2 gigahertz frequency, I make it 10 stage. You may get only 3 gigahertz. You may not get 4 gigahertz because of this reason, all right? So these are the couple of things that eat into your target frequency. And ultimately, indirectly what it means is that at that particular cycle time, whatever your target was, your effective CPI is actually bigger, right? You're losing double CPI. So super pipelining is a term that is used by the computer architects to essentially convey the phenomena that you're pipelining a processor too much, okay. All right? And that is what is used for getting faster clock frequency. So each pipe stage contains small amount of logic so that it can fit in small cycle time. May severely degrade your CPI if not careful. So we have just discussed 2 points why it can. Branch penalty is even bigger. We have talked about that. So Intel Prescott was one of the processors which Intel has produced in its history with the highest frequency. Right. It had a 31 cycle branch penalty. So at that point, actually, pretty much Intel had to stop the frequency boost because there are many other problems contributing to performance. So branch mispredictions cause massive loss in performance. For example, Prescott had an issue width of, fetch width of 3 microps every cycle. It could fetch 3 microps. So a 31 cycle loss would essentially mean 93 microps are lost. So every misprediction you make, you lose 93 microps, which is a big loss. You will fetch for 31 cycles along the wrong path and you'll have to throw all out. Okay, right. Long pipes also put more pressure on resources such as ROB and registers because instruction latency increases. Can somebody explain this particular point? Generally, what I'm saying is that if you have a deeper pipe, you might have to increase your ROB size and register file size. Why is that?
Because there's more instruction at the same time of the pipe.
Exactly. So since you have a deeper pipe, you'll have more instructions in the pipeline at any point in time compared to a shallower pipe. So you'll have to increase your ROB to accommodate these many instructions. And we already know that ROB size and register file size are connected to each other. So if you have a larger ROB, If you want to use the whole, the entire of ROP, you should have a larger physical register file also. And why is that a problem? Well, if you have a large register file, your register file access is going to increase in terms of latency. We talked about this last time. So smaller is faster. That's the thumb rule. If you make some structure bigger, it's going to be slower. So if you have a register file read that slows down, if you wanted this target frequency, you have to now have a deep, you have to pipeline the register file accesses. Introduce more pipeline stages. And essentially now it's a feedback loop, right? You make the pipe deeper and deeper, you need more and more registers. Okay. Your pipe will, you know, keep on getting deeper because you're trying to get that frequency. So essentially at one point you have to say that, well, I cannot make it any deeper. And what the penalty you pay is, you essentially won't be able to reach this target clock frequency. You have to run it at a slower clock frequency. That is what we actually thought we could do. So yeah, so instructions occupy ROP entry registers longer. The design becomes increasingly complicated where delay doesn't scale. So as somebody has just mentioned that the bypass network becomes slow. Essentially what it means is that the bypass values may not be delivered in time. Destination function. So till now, whatever design we have talked about, we said that, well, you bypass from one stage to another, the value reaches in one cycle, okay, right? Or immediately, it may not happen actually. Even if you have a full bypass, you may have to wait for some time just because the bypass path is very long. It's time to get there. Or the multiplexer becomes so wide that you just cannot accommodate it in time. So, it has many downsides, the super pipelining, so you have to be careful, because this is the point. It may severely degrade CPI if you're not careful. So here's an alternative. What if I don't make my pipeline deeper? I have a shallow pipe, but I have a wider issue. Essentially, what I'm saying is that I have a five-stage pipe. And I'm happy with a small top frequency. But what I do is, I issue 10 instructions every second. It's a very wide issue. So then I don't have all these problems that we just discussed. It's a shallow pipe, so my bypass network is simple. But now the burden is that you should be able to find those many independent instructions every second. Otherwise, you'll be wasting issue slots. So deeper pipeline gives you faster clock at the expense of increased branch penalty, possibly wider bypass. Wider issue reduces CPI by exposing more parameters. And which one is better? Depends on whether your program can offer so much of parallelism. That is, you can fill up your issue slots. So usually, again, there is a limit. So programs, it varies from program to program, but usually there is a limit. Beyond a certain point, you find that you are unable to fill up all the issue slots. And what are the other problems of having wider issue?
Circuitry is very complex actually.
Very complex. Okay.
Suppose there are n instructions in one library.
Yeah.
And there are n size of the issues, issue slot is n, say n.
Okay.
So it should be n cross m bypasses.
So every instruction will have to bypass to every other instruction, potentially. That's the maximum. Yeah. Right. Yes. Yes. And in addition to that, the circuitry to find independent instructions will have more comparators. Okay, because you know, you have to make sure that so essentially the wake up logic will be very complicated.
So you need
definitely
function in each other.
Yes, of course, yes. Yeah, otherwise yeah, don't have any meaning. That's right. Okay, so we'll wrap this up with a review of the P6 microarchitecture. So this goes back a long time, actually. It was introduced in Pentium Pro and was extended with MMX and SSC in Pentium 2 and Pentium 3. So what do these acronyms stand for? Everybody, I hope, must have heard of these. What is MMX? Multimedia extension. What is SSC? Somebody, what is SSC? I believe everybody has heard of this, right? SSE. Who has it?
Superscalar XE.
Sorry?
Superscalar XE.
No. What about superscalar? SIMB. First SSE. Sorry? Single instruction? Multi-unit. Yeah, that's the acronym for SIMD. Yeah. Yes? What is E? Somebody can anybody guess what is E?
Electronics embedded.
No. Extension. Okay. Extension. Yes? We have to find out.
Sound system.
No, it's sound. Okay. Sound. This is streaming SIMD extension. So they were introduced in Pentium 2 and Pentium 3. All right. Just go and Google if you SSE. All right. Streaming SIMD extension. So Pentium Pro was the first processor. It came after Pentium. Now, Pentium was a superscalar processor with two pipelines, but they were both in order. So they had this U and V pipes in Pentium. Pentium Pro was the first architecture which introduced this out-of-order execution and all other algorithms. It was a 14-stage RISC pipeline. So as I mentioned, even though x86 is a CISC ISA, internally they get translated to RISC microps. Right? So internally the pipeline looks exactly like, very similar to MIPS. So it's a RISC pipeline. 8 stages spent in the front end. So here is a breakup. 2-cycle fetch, 3-cycle decode. Can anybody guess why decode is so long? 2-cycle fetch, 3-cycle decode, 1-cycle rename, 1-cycle ROV allocate, and 1-cycle dispatch to reservation stations. So that's the front end. And then in the reservation station, the instructions may wait for arbitrary number of cycles. Then 3 stages in execution unit, and 3 stages in commit. So that's your 14-stage pipeline. Why is the decode so long?
ROV access
You need decode. You need ROV access for. How do we allocate the same?
Yes.
Why is decode so long?
You need to check for dependency.
No, not in the decode stage. That's down in the rename stage. Any intuition why? You are working with a processor in your homework, right? It's a MIPS processor. You have seen its decode logic. Sorry?
Variable instructions.
Well, the instruction set is very complicated. It's extremely complicated. So it takes a lot of smartness to decode x86 instructions, actually. Okay. So that's the reason why decode is so complicated.
Moreover, it has to decode from CIS complex to
yes,
micro
right.
operation.
Yes, right. Yeah. So that's where the translation also takes place. For lengthy instructions, execution stage gets elongated beyond 3 cycles. So this is the minimum 3-stage execution. It fetches 3 IA32 instructions every cycle. Who hasn't seen this particular term, IA32? Everybody, what does it stand for?
In architecture?
What is 32?
32-bit
Intel architecture, exactly. So it's 32-bit Intel ISA. Okay. So it fetches three IA32 instructions every cycle, with the limit that it can fetch up to 16 bytes. Okay. Right? So essentially what I'm saying is that it is a minimum of these two, three instructions or 16 bytes, whichever is minimum. It will fetch that much every cycle. Decoder translates this into six RISC-like microops. Again, this is a max bound on the decoder, decode bandwidth. You can decode maximum of six, can translate into six RISC-like microops. Four allocated to the first, one each to the next two. All right. So the four decoded microps, so these are static allocation of instruction to the translated microps. The first instruction will get four microps, all right? And one microp each to the next two instructions. Okay. If any instruction needs more than four microps, it is handled by the micro instruction sequencer, because you can see that this is the maximum, all right, that the decoder can handle translation. All right. Rename six microps every cycle. And this bandwidth has to match the decode bandwidth, so to make sure that the pipeline smoothly progresses. Otherwise, any of those, the renamer could not rename six instructions, six microps, the renamer would become a bottleneck, actually. So you have to make sure that the bandwidths match.
So in the decode stage,
yeah,
if the second instruction needs to be generates more than one microp,
yeah,
then it would be actually decoded in the next cycle?
Yes. So actually what they do is that they take these three instructions, internally they reorder them actually. Okay. So slot the complex instruction in the first slot and the other two slots are given the simpler instruction. But yes, it may not work on that. So it should just give you an idea about how the complexity of the decoder. Okay. It's fairly complicated actually. Okay, so rename six microps every cycle. And interestingly, Pentium Pro did not have any register in it. All right. So it looked like our initial design, a single issue queue, okay, with the renaming being done by the issue queue slots. And Pentium Pro called this particular, rename slots the retirement register file. So essentially, what they did was that the ROB entry had a special field, okay, which could store the value of an instruction, value produced by an instruction. And that particular field taken through all the ROB entries is called the retirement register file. And the name comes from the fact that the instruction executes, produces a value. The value is put in that that particular field. And it will remain in that field until the instruction retires. And at that time, the value will be copied from the RRF to the actual register file. So that's where the name comes from. And in some academic literature, it's also called RUU, Register of Unit. Although RUU is actually more complicated than RRF, and we will not talk about RUU actually. If you want to read about RUU, I can give you a reference for this. And it allocates six ROB entries. Again, this bandwidth has to match the decode and rename bandwidth, because if you're naming six every cycle, you better allocate six every cycle, okay, right? ROB size is 40. Every cycle it allocates six, and RRF is also 40, as you can guess, because RRF is essentially a field of each ROB entry, right? So if this is my ROB, RRF would also be the same size, right? You can see this particular field as an extension of this particular entry. So total size is 40. Okay. There is a unified 23 entry resolution station. So this is very different from the distributed architecture that we talked about. It's like a single issue queue, 20 entry issue queue. The register alias table to keep track of logical register to RRF map, just like the rename map we talked about in the class. Between two consecutive front end stages, there is a queue so that some slack can be afforded. So that's fairly obvious. So between every two stages, between fetch and decode, there will be a queue of instructions so that the fetch and decode can work at their own bandwidth, okay, as usual. Right? And same for the remaining stages also. For example, for some reason, the renamer may stall. What could be a reason why the renamer is stalled? Anybody guess? The decoder is not stalled, but the renamer is stalled. So that essentially means that you need a queue between decoder and renamer so the decoder can proceed until this queue fills up, while the renamer remains stalled. What could be a reason why the renamer is stalled? Sorry? There is no physical register. This is an RRF, right? But yes, you're right. So can you rephrase that, whatever you say, in the correct terms?
Basically, ROV
is full. Right? If ROV is full, that means ROF is full. Because these two are located together. Right? So the ROV allocated stall first, that will back propagate to rename, and gradually it will fill up the pipe. Right?
So, in the rename state, it allocates the RRF entry?
It doesn't.
There are two different stages, ROV allocated and rename.
Yes, right. Yeah. So effectively, yes, effectively it reserves the ROV entry at that point. By allocate, I mean at this stage, it finally writes the instruction in the ROV entry. So reservation already happens here in this particular stage. You mark which six entries will be allocated. But finally, you write the values of the instructions like opcodes and everything else in the next cycle. Okay, the fetcher uses a branch target buffer and a two-level SAT predictor. So there is a 4-bit history with each BTB set, and it's a 4-way 512 entry BTB. So there's a 10-cycle branch penalty. Why? Commits 3 microops per cycle. Maximum operating frequency is 200 megahertz. It might sound funny today, even to the standards. So that's your T6 microarchitecture. This one is a high-level block diagram, what it looks like. So this is the instruction fetch unit that talks to the BTB. This is the instruction decoder. This is a micro instruction sequencer. This is a register alias table, that's the rename mapper. That talks to the RRF and ROV, the reservation station, which issues instructions into the execution units. So let's see what units are here. So we have instruction execution unit, floating point execution unit, the address generation unit. So here you actually compute the addresses of the memory operations. And this is a memory instruction unit, which talks to the data cache, which goes to the bus interface unit to the next level of the cache. All right. Okay. And there's a memory ordering buffer, which maintains the order of those two instructions that go out to memory. So this right here is the system memory. Okay. So if you're interested in reading this paper, I can give you the reference. You can read more about it.